Today I'm going to be solving the Solids of Revolution question from this year's AA high-level exam. There isn't anything really surprising about this question. It's as usual, they give you the function, they tell you where it rotates, and you just have to calculate the volume by using the Solids of Revolution formula that is in the booklet. You could say that there is a little twist to the question because he's not actually asking you to calculate the volume, but instead he's giving you the volume and asking you to find something else that you might use to calculate the volume. But that is traditional as well, right? It's just asking the question backwards, and then you're going to work in terms of this value of age, and in the end you're going to set the whole volume equal to pi and solve an equation to find age. But the reason why I like this question is that the picture itself reminds me of one of my favorite questions that has nothing to do with Solids of Revolution, but it's one of my favorite examples to give when I am first teaching calculus and talking about optimization problems, which would be the question, what is the biggest cylinder that fits inside of a sphere? So that has the exact same picture. So I want to solve that one first, just so that you know what the Solids of Revolution question was reminding me of while I was solving it. And then I'm adding to my question the fact that the radius of the sphere is r, because that is something that you can read here. Of course, that is just the equation of a circle. Since you're going to have x equals that, then you square both sides of the equation and add y squared to both sides. This is the equation of a circle. The radius of the circle is r. Well, you're going to think of it as a sphere because you take this circle and rotate it this way, but that doesn't matter. What is interesting is to see where you can put the r in the picture. And there is a pretty obvious place to put it, which is the domain of the function. He gave us the y goes from negative r to r. So you can see this radius of the circle is r, and that radius of the circle is r. But the interesting thing is going to be that every other direction also gives us a radius of the circle. For example, the point where the cylinder is touching the sphere. And that's a difference between both problems that I'm solving here, because in the problem in the exam, the cylinder was fixed. It's that cylinder. And in my optimization problem, I'm considering all possible cylinders that kind of fit inside of the sphere in the same way. There are taller, thinner cylinders that also do that, like this green one that I've just added to the picture. And also there are shorter and wider cylinders that are also going to fit inside of the sphere, like the purple one there. And they all fit inside of the sphere in the same way, but clearly each one has a different volume. And that's exactly what the optimization problem that I'm thinking of is asking, which one has the biggest volume. Very tall, thin ones, if you take it to the extreme, it doesn't have a very big volume because it gets thinner and thinner and it kind of turns into a line segment, so that has volume zero. And on the other end, the shorter ones, if you make them too short, they also go to volume zero because they become just a circle. That is the kind of like the equator of that sphere, that also doesn't have any volume. So everybody in between has a volume, and this question is about which one has the biggest one. But as for the picture, what all of those cylinders have in common is that in all of them, I can pick the point where it's touching the sphere and mark the radius of the sphere there, just like I did with the red original one. So now you see that I've marked also the radius of the sphere in purple, and the radius of the sphere is green. And the picture is getting a little bit too busy to see all of that. But the important thing for my optimization problem is that they are all R. So I'm going to work in all of them just as if that was the hypotenuse of a right triangle, which is this. One of the vertices of the triangle is just the origin, like here. The hypotenuse is r. The angles are going to vary depending on what cylinder I'm using, but that doesn't need to be represented in this diagram. And then the hypotenuse is r. And the other vertex up here, I'm just going to call it generically xy because I don't know which angle I'm talking about, which triangle, which cylinder. But what I do know is that the variables x and y follow the equation of the circle because they are a point on that circle. And also you can see that just by Pythagoras in this triangle. You don't even have to think about a circle. Now I want to calculate the volume of the cylinder that this generic point is making. That's going to be a function. Then I'm going to optimize for the value of the independent variable to find which one gives me the biggest volume. So I apologize for the notation here, but the volume of a cylinder is pi r squared, which is the area of the base circle, times the height of the cylinder. But the problem is that this r is not this r, right? So we're going to change that very, very quickly to avoid the confusion. The radius of the base of the cylinder is this variable here, like you can see in the picture there. So that's x, and the height of the cylinder is actually what they called h in the problem from the exam. But in terms of this picture here, the height is twice of the triangle, because the triangle is just the top half of the cylinder. You have another bottom half right here, which is the same size. So 2y is going to be h. Now, just like every other optimization problem, the thing that I want to optimize is kind of depending in two variables, but I only want it to depend in one variable. So I do have a relationship between the two variables, which are x and y over there. So I'm going to use this to substitute in there so that I only have one variable. And I can do this either way. I can substitute x in terms of y or y in terms of x. But I think that in this particular case, it's going to be easier to substitute x in terms of y, because the x is squared in the formula and the y is not, so I want to avoid having a square root in there. X squared, on the other hand, is very easy to isolate here, so I'm just gonna put that into there. Then I've just organized it a little bit to make it look like something that I want to take the derivative of. And notice that it has become a function of y. I'm using y as the independent variable here. Now let's take the derivative. And let's set that equal to zero to see where the turning point is. And as for the optimization problem, this is where I'm going to stop, because the rest is just figuring out the value of x and then putting both in the volume to find out the actual volume of the largest cylinder. And also checking that this is a local maximum, because just having a derivative equal to zero is not enough. It could also be a local minimum, or it could be an inflection point. But I'm not gonna do these things now, because it's not really related to the problem that I actually wanna solve anymore. This part was mostly just because of the idea of placing the radius of the sphere there in the corner, because that's what's going to relate the h that you want to find in the problem to the other variables in the problem. Before we move on, let me just remind you of something else that is also kind of related to this, which is the fact that calculating the area of a circle by integrals can be annoying, but calculating the volume of a sphere using integrals is not as annoying. And that has to do with the presence of the square root, which in the previous optimization problem, I made a choice to avoid it, because working with the square root would make my functions harder to deal with. So I know we all know that the area of a circle is pi r squared, right? So the result is not going to be very surprising, but I still want to show you the steps to prove that the area is in fact pi r squared. And one of the ways that you can do that is by using the integral from the equation of a circle, area under the curve. And that's just going to give you the top half of a circle, because a circle is not really a function, because it doesn't pass the vertical line test, but that's fine, you can just multiply by 2. So you should at least be able to write down the integral. This represents the area of a circle. Actually calculating this integral though is annoying, because I'm going to have to give you a second there for you to come up with the answer by yourself. But I'm going to have to use trigonometric substitution. And that's often the thing about solids of revolution problems, because it's not a difficult concept in itself,
It's just a
So
formula.
you're integrating the volumes of several disks on top of each other and whatnot, but it's just a formula, and then you plug things in and you calculate. But the calculating is often the difficult part because it's an integral, and we know that integrals, depending on what function is inside, can be very annoying. So for the trigonometric substitution that we have to use here is r times sine of t. It could have been cosine as well, doesn't matter, but I'm going to use sine. And I am using r times that because there is also an r squared here. So I'm trying to get to the trigonometric relationship, like cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to 1. But this is not 1, this is r squared. So that's why I'm putting an r squared here as well to compensate for that. So here I've done the substitution. And now the trigonometric identity is going to appear in here because this is factoring out the r squared. I get a 1 minus sine squared, which is cosine squared. And then putting that together with this other part that was already here, you see that we have an integral of cosine squared, which I hope you know is one of the most annoying ones. I'm not going to do it in the video because that's too much of a detour in what I'm trying to talk about. But let me know if you want me to show you how to do that kind of annoying integral. And if that sounds like it would be interesting to you, then I can also slow this down because I know that I did it really fast. But what I really wanted to compare this to here was what happens when instead of calculating the area of a circle, I want to take this circle and rotate it to calculate the volume of a sphere as a solid of revolution. So I'm rotating around the x-axis there, as in the orange circles that I drew. And this time I'm not going to multiply by 2 because when I have the radius of the orange circle, I'm just going to use the whole area of the circle here because that's how the formula for a solid of revolution works. And the formula is exactly putting the area of the orange circle here, pi r squared. But the radius of the orange circle is the value of the function at that point, and the function is that. And that's exactly why this version of it, the volume instead of the area, is not annoying at all because the function had a square root. But the formula had a square, so those things canceled out, and this is the integral that I have to solve. Just don't forget that the variable that you're integrating in is x, it's not r. So x squared becomes x cubed over 3. But r squared is a constant, so when you integrate it dx, it becomes r squared times x. So after you finish plugging in the numbers, you will get the familiar formula for the volume of a sphere. Okay, so after that kind of a long introduction, let us finally solve the problem from the exam. He has a sphere that has been drilled through with a cylinder shape, and the volume of the remaining part, which is the part that is outside of the cylinder, is pi. He wants to know the height of the cylinder. So the top and the bottom of the sphere are not part of the shape anymore. That's why I'm erasing them. We should also erase the green and purple cylinders, which were from a previous problem. Excellent. So we are going to calculate the volume of revolution of that thing. It is being rotated around the y-axis, which means that my integral is going to be also in the y-axis. It's going to be from this point to that point, which I'm going to call minus h over 2 and h over 2. I'm going to write the integral here, and I'm already setting that equal to pi because that is the volume of the ring. So what are we integrating here? Well, it is a sphere, and we have the formula of the sphere, but it has a hole in the middle, so we should subtract something to take away the volume from the hole in there. You can do that inside of the integral or outside of the integral, it doesn't matter. I think I'm going to just put a dy here and subtract the cylinder outside because it's a cylinder. I know its formula, so I don't need an integral. But again, let's be careful. The formula for the volume of the cylinder is pi r squared h, but this r is not the r from the question. The r that I marked in orange here is this radius, the radius of the cylinder. And we are going to find out that radius in terms of the height and in terms of the actual r from the question by looking at this right triangle that is marked in red here. I really should have picked different colors because orange and red are very similar. But anyway, this is going to be gone very soon, right? Because this is just Pythagoras, and then I'm going to plug in this up here. So anyway, look what happened. The square root that I had coming from Pythagoras has also been canceled out because the orange r was squared. And over here inside of the integral, I've also canceled out another square with a square root, making it into a simpler thing. Now all of the pi's have canceled out. The integral was easy to do because it was the same one as in the other problem that I showed you. And now I just have to substitute the values from the fundamental theorem of calculus. This is looking very long and boring, but a lot of the terms are the same. So when I combine the like terms, it's going to look a lot better. And there you go, the cubic root of 6 was the answer to the problem.